Hi folks, this is part two or segment two of the versatile hunting dog training series with Jason Carter. In this segment, we're going to take a look at setting the foundation for a finished retrieve. Jason will discuss controlling the mouth, a look at hard mouth, force fetch, and much more.
Well, go ahead. So we have Blaine Carter here. He's the owner and one of the pro trainers here at Merriman Kennels. He's my best student. And we were talking earlier about controlling the mouth. And we started at a young age. Yeah. We start with the puppies and we start controlling what goes in, what comes out, what stopping them before they eat from the bowl. You know, at the puppy, the games we play. Mm-hmm. So we lead into really early. Maybe you can speak to this. Back in the day, people waited to start working on some of their conditioned retrieves later on in their training, and now we're starting much, much earlier.
Well, we used to do it right after naturability, so we were looking at dogs coming into force training, retrieving, or even the holding process at around 13 to 16 months of age, sometimes anytime after a year, and we always advocated that we wouldn't start any of that retrieving work until after permanent teeth came in. But that's all. That whole philosophy has changed drastically. We here at the kennel have really, we're almost starting them now at 10 weeks, 11 weeks, and the whole process, just the idea of, you know, the mouth.
Maybe I can show a little bit of that with Gritta here. Yeah. Gritta's just under a year. And what we do as the puppies go, when they're younger, just like you said, right out of the, when they go home, even do you start before they even get back to the buyer?
Of course, we're checking teeth.
Right.
You know, so we're constantly in their mouths, and we try a little early socialization with them, but, you know, puppies at that age is kind of tough.
Right.
Yeah.
So as they get a little older then, what we do is we just teach hold. And we usually have a glove on because puppies don't really like to put their teeth at that point, since we have bite inhibitors in place. They don't really want to put their teeth on you. And so what we do is we teach hold. And what it is I'm gonna put something in there. I have control of your mouth, and you just accept it. And as you can tell with Gritta here, Gritta's just relaxed. It's not much pressure. She's starting not to like it a little bit. So all I have to do is hold. So she realizes she doesn't have a choice. And we start that at a young age. And the battle really isn't that big. We don't really have the big fights anymore when we start at a young age.
With the whole process, it used to be we get a belly holding and then we went right into force.
Right.
But with what we're doing now is like we're teaching that young dog, for instance, like when I go over that canine, that means it's good. You know, it's good to do. It's good to go. And then when I come back against those canines and give them the draw, thank you, forgive it. So the dog's kind of learning that my mouth, I don't quite understand this, but, you know, what are you trying? And they're so moldable that you can teach them that pressure on, pressure off stuff that we like to start talking about.
So pressure on, pressure off.
Starts right here, right in that process.
So what that is pressure on, pressure off, tell me if I'm right here, is when starting at a young age, okay, hold.
That's pressure.
That's pressure.
Right.
Good girl. Pressure off.
Yeah.
And the sessions are very short.
Yeah. And if you talk, you will talk with a lot of trainers around the country. They like to say praise. It can be a distraction. I think in this process, praise is your best friend. If they accept this, okay, good dog. Thank you for letting me get in there. And now I'm in, oh, wow, good dog, good dog. So now I'm starting to play with compliance.
But I noticed your praise was metered a little bit.
Well, it depends on
the emotions of the dog. So and that's a good point to bring up is throughout, from the beginning to the end of our training, we're always dealing with the emotion of the dog. You're dealing with, if you get the dog too high in play, you start losing behavior that you want. So we're always in pointing. If you go in too fast or too much praise, then you'll get dogs that are breaking.
Right.
So we're always, throughout all of our training, is dealing with emotions of the dog and trying to infuse as much pleasure into the process as possible.
Yeah, and if you really wanted to look at the total process of that whole situation, would be balance. Teaching the dog to control his emotion is the balance between its desire to do something and his emotion for that particular desire, not to overly stem to a particular situation, and to relax this. Be able to relax pressure is as important as to create stimulus through pressure.
So let's go on to the next step in our hold process, where it's not just our hand, it's not a bumper, but it's weird objects, things that you don't think your dog would hold. It could be weights, it could be plastic, it could be metal,
right.
Just different things. We ask our dogs to hold a lot of different things. If we could grab some of the other dogs.
Bird Dogs Afield, presented by Native Performance Dog Food, providing performance diets for the canine athlete, and brought to you in part by RST, manufacturers of short chamber, low pressure shot shells. Mud River Dog Products, fundamentally changing the expectations of the hunter and dog enthusiast. Pete Shoe Dryer, inventor of the footwear dryer. Take on the nuisance of foot odor. Wooden Stream, outdoor footwear outfitting adventures since 1957. Visit woodenstream.com for a dealer near you. Canine Active, providing safe, non-toxic pain relief for your dog.
So, leading into the next step of this process, I mean, we're heading towards getting a finished retrieve. This is what we're doing here. But we need, and I think a lot of people miss this process in their training because they think their dog has enough natural retrieving, and then they run into the issue later on, and it becomes a big battle later on in the retrieving process. So, when you're doing the force process, the hold, we go into objects like metal, or we have heavy weights or heavy-ish weights. and things that the dog isn't used to holding, maybe that it would want to spit out.
Whoa.
And so what we do is we place it in there and we say hold. Initially, you could get a little battle, but our point of contact, we hold the dog right at its head and we control the head and we say hold. Whoa. The dog understands what to do. Hold. If the dog drops its head, you know it's trying to spit. If the dog tips its head from side to side, you know it's trying to get rid of it.
Whoa.
So what we're trying to do here is trying to get the dog just to hold the object. What you're going to do then is you're going to take your hand off the object and see if the dog will just hold it. Hold. Hold. Not a lot of pressure. Not a lot of force. It's hold. And once you have that understanding, then the dog will be able to hold glass, hold metal, hold any different type of object. And you're just trying to get the dog to understand that I'm giving you something. I know you don't like it, but you're going
to
hold it.
Yeah, and we also want them to drop. To teach them to hold, the drop is expected. We really want that.
That's a huge point.
Right.
And everyone always, I want a perfect training day. I don't want to make any mistakes. I'm going to deny the dog the opportunity to make a mistake.
Yeah.
When you do that, and you're, especially you see it in heel, and we'll get to heel later, but in heel process, a lot of people have those tight leashes because they're afraid their dog's going to pull too far out ahead. But you miss the opportunity to teach a lesson at that point.
I think every mistake a dog, and I think you agree as well, anytime they make a mistake is a training opportunity. So everyone thinks that mistakes are bad. I think they're great.
Absolutely.
It's a training opportunity.
See, here at the when we see our dogs and we're training our dogs here, when we expose an issue,
right?
A lot of times the owners are like, oh man, oh, my dog's not doing well. But we're thinking, great, you got something to work on. Go home, you got the week. We'll see you next week.
See you next week and see what happens.
And see what you do.
Right.
Because if you expose an issue, then you can train it.
Right. I mean, why have it surprise you? Expect it. You know, if you expect your mistakes, then you can put clarity to your process. And I think that's really important.
So let's up the challenge here. We got some good dogs here. All right, hold an object. I want to see if we can leave the dog on the table and step away from our dogs. We can step back, hold.
Fetch.
Hold. And I want you to notice the connection. All of the dogs are pretty much connected to their owner. There's a line of communication, an understanding in the training process where we can look at our dogs and give them the hairy eyeball or give them the stance. A lot of us stand in a certain way where the dog says, oh, he means business, he's in his training stance. And that brings up a point in the visual concepts that the dogs pick up. We say a lot of different things. Some people have full-on paragraphs and conversations with their dogs that are just too much. Just the sound. They pick up on the littlest things. Or body language. On how we if we stand up taller, we drop a hand there to heel. 80% of what they're learning and seeing is visual. So if we want to give them a crutch, hold. What we can do is give them visuals. And it could be initially big crutches like big hands, whoa. Or it can be, well, the understanding of that is we want to back away from our crutches. After you give them a crutch, you give them a visual to use, then you want to back away. You want to start getting rid of those crutches. And eventually, you don't need to use them. Hold.
And that's a good thing. You know, it's like commanding. Like when you, even in the hold. Instruction, right now, the only thing we're actually working on is I'm expecting her to drop. So when she drops, I'm going to make the proper correction at that time. Whoa.
At that time.
Right. And well, that's timing.
Okay, timing is really important.
Whoa.
So you almost have
Sit.
To catch yourself,
Sit.
Stop yourself, because I'm looking at Gritta here, and she's about to drop that. And I'm going to try to either catch it before it hits the ground, or I'm going to give that verbal cue, hold, at the right moment. And so that learning is very clear, and the dog understands it. I think we're
Sit.
Good.
Hi, folks. Just a quick break for a sponsor's message. We'll be right back with more Bird Dogs Afield.
Hi, folks. Our dogs work very hard for us. They need and deserve a high-performance dog food. My choice is Native. Native has been formulated for the canine athlete. It has none of the low-value, hard-to-digest fillers such as soy, corn, wheat. It has only high-grade chicken and high-grade digestible grains. It comes in four levels of fat and protein. Each level is formulated for the stress and activity level for your dog at that time. Make the switch today. Your dog will be happy, and so will you.
Hi, Bird Dogs Afield viewers. I'm here today with Dylan, who's almost 10 years old and still hunting hard. So in order to help him, we use Canine Active. It's for working and hunting breeds, and it is my go-to for pain relief and for an anti-inflammatory. You can use it before strenuous activity to help keep them moving and help reduce muscle soreness, or you can use it after for recovery. Try it today, Canine Active.
You now need to go to your dog, and a lot of times at this point the dog will drop the object. I want to see you guys go and try to get the retrieve without it dropping. And then what is the next most important part?
Just assure the action. Ah! Fetch.
Randy, when you get a nice retrieve, what's your next thing?
Praise.
We're going to love our dogs up, and that is huge. All right, so let's get the retrieves.
Drop. Go ahead.
Good girl. Good girl. Yeah, good girl.
Can we have a party? That payoff is what the dog looks for.
Hup. Sit.
Good? Come. So let's take this to the next level. Let's have a little fun here. Let's do a little what we call our cracker challenge. And what we're going to do is we're going to ask these dogs to hold food. Whoa. Now, the real idea of this is we are able just to demonstrate that we can control what goes in the dog's mouth and when we want it presented to us. even if it's food,
maybe.
And a dog that has a hard mouth isn't really going to provide us much for the table. We're not going to be able to eat whatever it brings back. So we control that right from the beginning, right from when the dog is very young, is we teach it that you're gonna hold this, you're not gonna crunch it, you're not gonna chew on it, and that way we have game for the table. So let's all grab a cracker. Pizza. I want to see you guys hold it. And we'll make this not you, not you. The dog.
Why?
Hold.
Fergie.
Hold.
Fergie.
Hold.
Whoa.
Hold. Hold.
Fetch.
Triscuits aren't cracked.
Oh.
Fetch.
Is this a new challenge?
Hold.
Fetch.
Hold.
Whoa. Whoa.
Whoa. All right, so let's up the ante. You guys are doing pretty good. Well, some of us.
Whoa.
Sometimes so, we hear the cracker
hold.
Going.
Yep. Hold. I'm not doing well either.
Fat.
Hold. Hold.
Hold.
Hold. Okay, let's see if you can step back, step away from your dog without it eating it. You need a new cracker. I need a new cracker.
I'm out.
I'm out. How many do we have left now? All right. Oh, so we got 7-year-old Hogan and Tiza. Oh, you're back in?
Yeah, I'm back
That's
in.
That's cheating, you know.
Whoa.
Whoa.
Hold.
Fetch.
Whoa.
Hold.
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 Whoa.
Hold. Ah. Oh, my God. Hold.
Hold.
Fetch. Fetch. Now, whoa.
Well, we're certainly finding some weaknesses
whoa.
Here. Hold.
Ah. Whoa.
Hold.
Ah.
Hold. Hold.
Ah.
Hold. Hold. All right, let's have the young puppy hold. See if it can return with the cracker. Great, heel. Hold. Whoa. Whoa. Ah. Whoa. Okay, good girl. Well, that didn't work.
But, you know, realistically.
It's a Triscuit challenge.
Yeah. Realistically, if you thought about everything that we were doing in there, was even though, I mean, they're really stimulated.
Here, yeah, sure.
You know, in
sure.
a lot. But we were controlling the urge, what he wanted to do behavior-wise, in that dog's
So you're
behavior.
Saying if a dog's on point, you may have some other urges you're going to try to control later on?
Yep, sometimes, yeah. Yep. And, you know, but the ability just to be able to say, fetch, don't chew, don't take that is what we use. That one little thing, like a hard-mouthed dog, is you stop that, right? That's overexcitedness. So we're actually controlling how that dog's, he says, I want to eat it. I got to eat it. I mean, this thing is mine. I possess it. I own it. I don't want to share it. And we actually now can get that dog to stop that and then teach him to be cooperative.
Really?
To share.
Really?
Yeah.
So I might have a bird on me here.
Yeah.
And I want to see you do it with this one.
With a bird?
With a bird. Okay. Now we're going to eat this when we're done.
Yeah.
So I want this fit for the table.
Okay.
Think you can pull that off?
No. Sit. Now let's. I'm gonna work with the overexcitedness first. Okay. You want it, huh? What? Huh? You want it? No. It's mine. It's mine. Leave it. Fetch. So now I want her to come at it slowly. Huh? Fetch. 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 Right here. Whoa. Fetch. Fetch. So now there's none of this. You see, there's not that. I got to have it. I want to flip it. I want to play with it. No, you fetch, you hold, you control it. And you give it to me. Drop. Thank you.
So I noticed that there's no mouthing. The teeth aren't entering the meat.
No. And she knows. Well, see, she wants to play with it right now. Fetch. Fetch. You hold.
This brings up a good point in training, and not just for this, but in all the pieces of your training,
drop.
Is that you need to have, you need to be able to take your finished product, have the understanding of what your finished product is, and then start by making small pictures that shape and change
Leave it.
Those behaviors towards that
Leave it.
Finished product. So taking this little lesson here,
correct.
You get the understanding here.
Yeah, and then I can transfer it.
Okay, what would the next step be?
For this particular portion?
Yeah.
After I had the hold and carry portion of it.
So you do hold and carry?
Yeah.
Do it.
Okay.
Hi, folks. Just a quick break for a sponsor's message. We'll be right back with more Bird Dogs.
I'm wearing the new Maniac boot from Wooden Stream. Hunting boots, more like athletic footwear for hunters. At just over 2 pounds, this may be the lightest hunting boot ever.
More important, Maniac's free-floating lace system connects to the sole, so when you lace up, the boots conform to your feet.
This dramatically reduces boot slop, toe jam, and heel lift, meaning virtually no hot spots, blisters, or sore feet.
Maniac, try one on at your local Wooden Stream dealer.
Friends, you know, whether you're a hiker, hunter, jogger, walker, all of those activities create sweat and moisture in your footwear. That moisture leads to bacteria, mildew, mold, all bad things for your feet. To eliminate that moisture, you need a peat shoe dryer. The new PowerCell Peat eliminates that moisture and creates a better atmosphere for good foot health.
Hi folks, you know, we spend a lot of money on our dogs, on our guns, on our travel. Sometimes we overlook our shot shell, and that delivers the payload, you know. RST is my choice. It's a premium shell, high performance, low pressure. Check it out today. This is the shell you want this fall. RST shot shells.
Come. Here. Sit. Fetch. Come. Come. Come, good girl. Heel. Come. Drop.
Great, perfect. So the next step would be on the ground?
Transfer to the ground.
Yeah.
Right?
Let's do it on the ground.
I probably would start because of hold and carry, and she's so far along with the force training, yep. I would now start doing a walking pickup.
Sure.
Take it to a finish,
That would be good, nice to see.
Just by setting it there. Come.
So to lead into that, you're expecting her to come up, and you're not going to stop. You're going to flow
Heel.
Right through, and when you do that, she's going to pick up on the run.
What I'm expecting is her to see that bird. I'm not going to say a word. I want her to come down, pick it, control it properly, and continue with me, and then I'm going to bring her back to the table, and I'm going to ask her to finish, meaning come, sit, and then I'll take the bird away.
Okay.
All right.
Let's do it.
Friggy, come. And drop. Okay. And then once I have the walking pickup, I'm going to start the send to. And then
you want to do it from the table? You want to send her down there and then send to, pick it up?
I can do it right here on the table. Here, come. Here. Sit. 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 Whoa. Fetch. And she's now starting to get a little rolly with me, but I want to control that.
Sure.
I want her to understand it. Now what I'll do is I'll go from the table to the ground.
I think another note is, initially we start this with bumpers.
Yeah.
This is kind of the end process, because when we go to birds, a lot of times in our training, we kind of take a big back step. And in training, everyone's always afraid of that big back step, retraining something you've already done.
Right.
It's really important that, and I'm sure you agree, that taking back steps, especially in our retrieving process, is a good thing. You find a hole in your training, you can always go back and fill those holes.
Oh, for sure. Like, for instance, like if I had she wasn't sitting or she's not finishing correctly, then I would do recall work and create that finish. When I say come, you come to a place and this is where that delivery is going to be, right? And then once I get through that, I'm teasing the crap out of her. Once I get through that portion of it, you know, like you do, is then I'm going to start the send to part of it, and hopefully that she automatically knows where that finish is. And so when I send it to something, she goes out, picks it up, she should come right back to the retrieving position, which is, for me, it's left side sit.
Because you're right-handed with a gun.
I'm a right-hander.
Okay, very nice.
Bird Dogs Afield, presented by Native Performance Dog Food, and brought to you in part by RST Shot Shells, Mud River Dog Products, Peach Shoe Dryer, Wooden Stream Outdoor Footwear, and Canine Active.